R109690, State of Kansas v. Darnell Lee Huey.
May it please the court, Sam Shire of the Kansas Appellate Defender Office appearing on behalf of the defendant appellant, Darnell Huey. Your Honor, may I please reserve 3 minutes of rebuttal argument?
3 minutes is granted.
Thank you, Your Honor. To summarize the facts for the audience, back in 2010, Mr. Huey entered an apartment and committed a robbery inside. Preliminary hearing testimony from two witnesses indicated that Mr. Huey was brandishing a firearm while committing this robbery. But preliminary hearing testimony also indicated that Mr. Huey was chased from the scene of the robbery by police officers, and police officers did not find a firearm in his possession when he was arrested. Police were also not able to find a firearm on the path that he took to evade arrest. It appears from the record that Mr. Huey has denied from the start of this case that he possessed a firearm during the commission of a robbery. Eventually, Mr. Huey pled guilty to the offenses of simple robbery and aggravated burglary. Neither of those offenses requires as an element of the offense possession of a deadly weapon. At sentencing, the district court imposed a prison sentence and also made a deadly weapon finding on the record. This subjected Mr. Huey to a period of offender registration for 15 years. We appealed to the Court of Appeals, arguing that the district court's deadly weapon finding violated Mr. Huey's right to a jury trial as guaranteed by the Sixth Amendment of the United States Constitution. The Court of Appeals rejected that argument, petitioned this court, and that is why we are where we are today.
Can I clarify something? Make sure I understand correctly. The witnesses said that he had a long, skinny weapon that had a pistol grip at both ends, at the rear, front and rear. You don't recall that?
Well, I recall the pistol grip. That's basically my recall.
Well, what I'm seeing is skinny weapon that had a pistol grip in the front and rear. And he said he had a crowbar.
Right, Your Honor.
And yes. So what the court did was say, I'm going to make the finding that that was a weapon and not a crowbar.
Right, Your Honor, yeah.
Okay, without further evidence at sentencing.
The district court just relied on the preliminary hearing testimony. We believe that that violated Mr. Huey's constitutional right to a jury trial. And I would start out by noting...
But just to continue clarifying, you're arguing the district court judge had no business trying to resolve any factual dispute that there may have been with the record, right?
Absolutely, Your
Honor. You are not arguing that there wouldn't be enough evidence in the record to necessarily find one way or the other. Your argument is who has the proper role to play in making the finding.
That's absolutely correct, Your Honor. There's substantial competent evidence to support the court's finding, but we think that finding should have been made by a jury if it was made at all. And I think the state would agree that if violent offender registration is punishment, this case presents a pretty clear-cut Apprendi violation. And I know this court heard multiple arguments yesterday dealing with the punitive nature of drug offender registration, and I think there will be a substantial amount of overlap between those arguments and the arguments that I would advance in this court today. But I would like to emphasize an argument today, the differences that I see between violent offender registration ordered pursuant to KSA 2249-02-E2 and sex offender registration, something that this court has recently held to be non-punitive. And I would start out by noting that as I read State versus Peterson Beard and Smith v. Doe, offender registration in those cases was deemed non-punitive in very large part because of the unique danger that sex offenders pose to society. I think that everyone would agree that sex offenses cause a great deal of pain and suffering to individual victims and society at large. I think that most people would agree that they are among the worst of the worst criminal offenses that can be committed. And in Smith v. Doe, the United States Supreme Court additionally reached the conclusion that sex offenders as a class pose a uniquely prone to recidivism. So I think it's this combination of the degree of harm which is caused by potential future sex offenses and the perceived likelihood of recidivism of sex offenders that makes sex offender registration non-punitive.
Is there anything that we can look at that goes beyond what might even be a reasonable perception? We ran into this problem yesterday, I think probably as you know. The arguments may even be valid, but how do we know?
Well, Your Honor, I think...
Is there anything in this record?
The record doesn't have any evidence of recidivism one way or the other in this record. My response to this court would be that Smith v. Doe certainly did make part of its holding. It deemed it important that sex offenders had, I believe, a shockingly high rate of recidivism. That's something the Doe court relied on. So to some extent, that would
But we don't know what the recidivism... We have nothing of evidentiary value, no facts developed below that would allow us to come to the conclusion that violent offenders may have a different recidivism rate, do we?
Well, I basically agree with Your Honor. There's no evidence one way or the other, which I think distinguishes this case from Doe. The other thing I would say is that if we look at the class of offenders in this case, it is extraordinarily broad. Sex offenders is a relatively discrete class of criminal offenders. People who commit person felonies, that ranges the gamut from criminal threat, a severity level 9 offense, to intentional murder. And so I would argue that there's no conceivable way this broad gamut of criminal offenses, that they could all have the same likelihood of recidivism. I think this is sort of a one-size-fits-all approach, and that this overly broad class of offenders mitigates against any finding that this is non-punitive. And I would also note that I think at some point the logic of Smith versus Doe would have to break down, and that offender registration would have to be punitive as applied in some circumstances to some classes of offenders. A hypothetical example I would give of that would be that if the legislature amended CORA such that all persons convicted of misdemeanor theft were required to register as theft offenders for the remainder of their life. I don't think the legislature would do that, but if it did, I don't think that this court would have any difficulty in concluding that that constituted punishment. And the reason for that would be is that society's need to be protected from people who commit petty theft offenses would be very disproportionate to the burdens that CORA would impose upon individuals who were convicted of a simple misdemeanor offense. So with that in mind, I think I'd like to compare the actual class of offenders that we have in this case, which again is just anybody who has been convicted of a person felony. And again, because we have this broad range of offenses, I don't think somebody convicted of a criminal threat offense is at all comparable to somebody who has been convicted of a rape offense or an aggravated criminal sodomy offense. They're just not comparable types of offenders. So for that reason, I think it is punitive in this case to impose offender registration. The other distinction that I'd like to note between this case and Peterson Beard is that I think there may be a Mendoza-Martinez factor at play in this case that wasn't in play in Peterson Beard. And that is whether offender registration relied upon a finding of scienter. In this case, not all individuals convicted of person felonies are required to register. Only those individuals, when a district court makes a factual finding that the offense was committed with a deadly weapon. So what I would argue is basically the district court is being put in a position where it needs to find whether an aggravating circumstance accompanies a particular criminal offense. And this is certainly appears to be essentially a sentencing enhancement. The district court is making its own factual finding with regard to an aggravating circumstance and using that to impose a particular type of sentence upon an offender. So that also bodes in favor of declaring violent offender registration, in this case, punishment.
And you're just arguing the effects.
Our primary argument is the effects, Your Honor. Punitive intent is also an issue that this court is before this court. I believe it was noted yesterday that...
We're not bound by Myers because of the factual distinction that they amended to add drug offenders and violent offenders. Is that your argument?
Yes, Your Honor, yes. And my argument in that regard is that sex offender registration came first, which would tend to indicate that the legislature viewed sex offenders as the most serious type of offenders. If we look at the criminal code, it's also reflected in the punishments for sex offenses. If I committed any type of person felony, my maximum term of post-release would be 36 months. Sex offenses, it's basically going to be, as a matter of law, lifetime post-release. And I think this reflects a legislative finding that sex offenders do pose a unique threat of recidivism and need longer periods of monitoring. The other thing I would note in that regard is that, again, this cuts back to the scienter argument, but the way KSA 22-4902-E2 operates, it very much looks like a sentencing enhancement. Somebody's convicted of a crime, a district court needs to decide whether an aggravating factor exists, and only if that aggravating factor exists is the court allowed to impose offender registration. So I think that would lend itself to a finding that the intent of the legislature in this case was punitive. Unless this court has any further questions.
Does there need to be any, or can we consider the rational relationship between the regulation and the protection intended? In other words, obviously with sex offenders, if you notify people where they live, where they work, where they go to school, they can keep their kids away from that sex offender, or they can avoid that person and reduce the chances of being the victim of that crime. But here we have someone that broke into an apartment, committed a robbery. How would the registration and public notification made any difference for that victim on being able to protect themselves?
Well, I think that's a good point, Your Honor. In this case...
But it may be a good point, but where does it fit in? I'm asking you, can we consider that? Where does it fit into the Martinez-Mendoza factors?
Well, I think it fits into the factor of whether the regulation is excessive to the proffered basis for the regulation. So in this case, in our view, violent offender registration is excessive, and this is the primary problem on the effects-based test. Again, to go back to the theft hypothetical, at some point, the rationale of Smith v. Doe would have to break down. With some classes of offenders, it cannot be the case that the justification for registration.
That's like a proportionality overlay, right? I mean, that's how we might characterize it. You're talking about once it becomes so disproportionate and it has to break down, right?
Well, yes, Your Honor.
I mean, that's what in essence you're saying. It's like a proportionality overlay. But we don't get to proportionality unless something's punishment, right? I mean, still we have that core question, unless that whole mode of analysis is infirm.
Well, I think one of the Mendoza-Martinez factors, Your Honor, is whether the regulation is excessive. And that's what my best argument to this court today, I think, would be on the effects-based test, is that this regulation is just far more excessive than is necessary to protect society.
Based on what? How do you make that argument? What fact do you use to say that this is overkill?
Well, Your Honor, what I would rely upon is I think that sex offender registration may be the exception to the rule. And that sex offenders, because of their unique recidivism rates, the unique danger that they pose to society, are the class of individuals which can be monitored in a way that is not punitive.
Do you really want me to go dig around on the internet and see what I can find about recidivism rates with violent offenders or criminals who use deadly weapons and see what their recidivism rate is? Because, I mean, how else would I do that? I don't have anything in the record that makes a case for that.
Well, Your Honor, I would agree with you that I don't think it would be appropriate to necessarily go outside of this record. But I would also note that that's exactly what the court did in Smith versus Doe, and that informed the decision in Smith versus Doe, and that it simply isn't the case in this case that there's anything that would tend to indicate that people who commit person felonies are, as a class, uniquely prone to recidivism.
I'm not sure that's true. I mean, if I dig around in the Department of Justice statistics, and I have, I don't know that you want us doing that and just deciding that, look at this percentage versus that percentage in the Justice Department records. I mean, without more, without having it vetted, without you having an opportunity to say, no, that percentage is wrong or those numbers are wrong, regardless of what Smith versus Doe did with at the U.S. Supreme Court level. I mean, do you really want us to be digging around on the internet looking for statistics that we can stick in here one way or the other? It's really my question.
And my answer, Your Honor, is no. What I would say, though, in addition to that, is that if we look at the class of offenders in this case, I would argue that it is so exceptionally broad that I don't see how there could be a consistent recidivism rate across the broad spectrum of individuals convicted of person felonies. This is such a broad class of offenders that I don't think they can all be lumped together and treated the same.
Do you have any further questions? Thank you, counsel.
Good morning. May it please the court, the state appears by Deputy District Attorney Jody Litvin. The state's position here is that if we look at the essential holding in Apprendi and look at what the critical question in Apprendi was, is does this triggering mechanism done by the district court, does this finding by the district court implicate Apprendi's essential focus, which is prohibiting a sentencing judge from imposing a more severe sentence than the maximum sentence authorized by the facts found by the jury? And our position is that it does not. Whether you consider this a sentence, a part of the sentencing, which we don't believe it is, given Simmons and some other case law which has come forward since the briefs in this case, or whether it's considered punishment, which Peterson Beard has held that it's not. The state does not find that there should be a distinction made between sex offenders and violent offenders or drug offenders, as this court has held in Peterson Beard that it's
not. Why not?
Because the purpose is the same. I guess the state doesn't believe that there should be a different purpose for registration.
Well, you could say public safety and just say, you know, it creates a public safety problem for people to jaywalk, and people are likely to jaywalk again, so the recidivism rate is frightening and high, and so they have to report every day for the rest of their life. And that's okay?
I believe the legislature could do that, and then someone would have to
Wouldn't be punishment for that person that has to report every day. That's not punishment.
If the purpose and the intent behind the act of CORA is to promote public safety and to provide notice to the public of these offenders that are in the community, no. And I think here, importantly, there is no record of any of this. This was presented as an Apprendi challenge. There's been a ton of case law that's come out and litigation that's come out after these cases, but we don't have any evidence as to why this violent offender here, why it is punishment as to him. And so I don't know that this court can make that finding in this case in particular.
Let me narrow down what we're talking about here, and I get back to the facts. You don't contend that Mr. Huey really did admit to the use of a deadly weapon in his plea agreement or in the colloquy with the district court over entering the plea, do you?
That he did?
Yeah,
that
you
he
don't,
agreed
you don't,
that he used a deadly weapon?
Yeah, you haven't made the argument. Your argument is Simmons. That's what you spend all your time on with Corey. You don't claim that he really did make the admission about using the firearm. And so Apprendi's not even involved because you've got it right there in front of you. This is still all about who gets to make the decision, correct?
Well,
one way around Apprendi would have been if he would have entered a plea that had as an element of it a deadly weapon, and he would have admitted in the course of entering his plea that that element was present, right?
Yes.
So you're not arguing that. We're still focused on who gets to make the finding. And in this case, it was clearly the district judge that made the finding.
Yes.
So your argument is Simmons, as I read your brief.
Well, Simmons wasn't out of the time of briefing. We did do supplemental briefing that mentioned Simmons and Peterson Beard. I guess what I relied on in my brief was Chambers and Unrein and some of the
I
other...
And I meant Chambers.
Okay, yes.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
We've had so many of these things that they're really... But
there's a lot of cases that have come out since the briefing.
You relied on Chambers.
Yes.
Explain to me how Chambers is correct.
Chambers held... In the state's view, Chambers looked at what Apprendi's focus was. And that says, does it increase the maximum statutory sentence? I think they used sentence. There has been used penalty. There has been used punishment. Does it somehow increase the sentence, penalty, or punishment? And this finding done by the district court that triggers registration, which has been held not to be as a part of a sentence, which I think even came from Jackson from this court in 2010, if it doesn't increase the sentence, then it's not an improper factual finding that had to be made by a jury.
Is that still good law?
Yes, the state believes it is.
Okay, why?
Because Peterson Beard has come out and since said that it's not punishment for any purposes. Simmons has since come out and said that it's not a part of the sentence at all. It's a complete, wholly distinct civil remedial statute, separate and distinct from the criminal sentence. So how is it enhancing the sentence if it's a civil collateral consequence of the sentence? I guess it's not enhancing the sentence by the statutory length. His prison sentence was 57 months or something like that, which fell within the statutory maximum. And this isn't considered punishment or any sort of penalty, so how is it an improper factual finding that's increasing the penalty? And I think that that Chambers still stands, and that the cases that this court has come out with since continue to support Chambers. Now, if this court wants to make some sort of distinction between sex offenders and violent offenders, I don't know that we have anything in this record that can do that.
But before you go that, are you done?
Yeah.
I want to go back to your reliance on Simmons. And I want you to explain why we have the district court required to make a finding on the record here with regard to a deadly weapon being used if that fact is not an element of the crime and the registration is a collateral, a non-punitive collateral consequence of judgment that arises automatically by operation of law, as Simmons said, then why is the judge involved in something that the judge has no control over? It's, you understand what I'm asking you?
Yes.
If it's not part of the sentence and it's not an element,
yes.
Why is the judge required to make a finding on the record?
That's what triggers. There's a finding necessary in certain cases, and I don't know the statute, the exact numbering of the statute, but if it's not one of the enumerated crimes that's listed, the sex crimes that are listed under CORA, if it's not one of the violent crimes that are specifically listed, there are certain situations where the statute allows for a finding to be made by the judge in order to trigger registration when there's a deadly weapon finding.
But it doesn't happen automatically. It doesn't arise automatically. If the judge has to make a post-conviction finding, and that's what has to happen,
and
that all feeds into both the intent and the effects that the judge is participating into in saying what happens to this person as a consequence of the specific crime, and so I don't see how you can have it both ways.
I think it's just the mechanism that's provided for in the statute. When it doesn't automatically arise as one of the crimes that are listed, that automatically triggers it. I think that it is proper that a judge can make this finding since it's not enhancing the sentence, and it still is just can arise automatically as an operation of law after the judge makes that finding. And I think Apprendi's essential focus is, does it enhance the sentence or does it enhance the penalty? And that's not the case here.
I just want to clear up maybe a little bit of factual confusion. In this case, although he was originally charged with an ag robbery, he pled to the lesser, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, in fact, neither of the crimes to which he entered a plea or for which he entered a plea had use of a deadly weapon as an element.
I believe that's correct.
Yeah, I believe ag burglary is a result of an occupied, right? Being occupied. That's what makes ag burglary. It's not the weapon. And then garden variety robbery doesn't require a weapon, right?
Yes, I believe it went from ag robbery and theft, then there were some amendments, and then we ended up with robbery and ag burglary.
In spite of Mr. Shire's acknowledgement there was substantial competent evidence, it's getting back before Justice Biles saying that this is clarifying that this is about the judge's capacity to make the finding rather than the evidence used to support the finding. But what was the evidence to support? What substantial competent evidence is there to find that there was a deadly weapon? Seems to me that it was disputed, and the district court the judge went back to some recollection of preliminary hearing testimony. Wasn't very clear about what, I can't remember which judge, what he or she was relying on, but where did that come from?
And to my recollection, Your Honor, at the plea hearing, I don't know if there was an actual factual basis or if the prosecutor...
At the plea hearing, there was not a factual basis for a deadly weapon.
Yeah, and I believe the prosecutor said, based on the affidavits, the reports, and the testimony at preliminary hearing. And so when we get to sentencing, when the prosecutor made that request again, I believe he pointed the judge to, remember at the preliminary hearing, there was specific testimony from the victim and the witness, or whoever the two people were inside the apartment, where they specifically described this gun. Maybe a weird description of a gun with a long barrel and a handle, and it was definitely a handgun, but they both had specific testimony that the defendant had a gun. So I think that was the substantial competent evidence, and the judge said, I do remember that there was specific testimony by both of the witnesses describing in detail a handgun.
But before that happened, am I correct that this is the case where defense counsel reminded the judge that there was also testimony about it not being a firearm or a deadly weapon? And so the judge was reminded there's a conflict in the testimony from the preliminary hearing, and the judge made a factual finding from that.
And Your Honor, I cannot remember whether, I don't know that there was evidence at the preliminary hearing that he had a crowbar, or if the defense counsel was just saying in that moment at sentencing.
I think that's in his statement.
Okay.
And they found a crowbar.
Okay.
He said he had one, and by golly, here it was.
Right.
Nobody ever found a weapon, or a firearm, I should say.
Then I guess, yes, that would be true that
That's why I've tried to narrow you down on, we're not talking about whether the defendant admitted the element that you need for Apprendi purposes. This is all about really the process, the procedure.
Right, and I guess our argument would go back to, if it's not enhancement, then the process was, that the judge made the finding was okay.
Counsel, let's assume for the moment, for the purpose of my question, that you're right about that, that this is a civil remedial administrative scheme, not punishment, so Apprendi's not implicated. But my question is, what recourse would someone who has this civil administrative scheme imposed upon them, what recourse would they have to challenge the evidence supporting the factual finding that triggers the scheme? I mean, aren't there still some due process rights there, even if it's a civil scheme? If it's an arbitrary imposition, doesn't there have to be some kind of mechanism of appeal or challenge of that administrative decision?
Well,
and if the, and then I yes. would follow up on, if there isn't, how does that weigh in our calculation as to the big question, which is this really a civil administrative scheme?
I guess
you understand my question?
I think so. And maybe I'll use one of the prosecutor's answers from yesterday in that there could bring a civil lawsuit.
So if a judge makes a finding that a deadly weapon was used and the defendant believes, rightly or wrongly, that that finding is not supported by evidence, his only option is to sue, file a civil lawsuit. He has no administrative appeal remedy. He has nothing. He has to go get a lawyer, file a lawsuit against the state of Kansas. I mean, is that the current status of the law? Is there any other mechanism in statute by which this person could challenge that finding?
And Your Honor, I didn't prepare for that. I mean, we got to this through a direct appeal. So I suppose if he objected, and there would just have to be
do you think that question has any relevance on the question that we're actually here to decide, which is this scheme a scheme of punishment, or is it an administrative civil scheme?
You mean the remedy that they might have if they are aggrieved?
Is this a relevant question? Is this relevant to the ultimate determination we need to make?
I guess my position would be no. Our position would be no, and that if we're looking at it specifically for Apprendi purposes, the critical question is whether it's considered a sentencing enhancement or punishment.
Where it would be relevant, if the legislature did not provide a means to challenge that factual finding other than a direct appeal of the criminal case, if that is the only place that a person can challenge that, then one is moving towards the intent is penal. Because if they intended you to get recourse or get relief through the criminal case as the only means to do so, then that looks more like the intent is penal rather than civil regulatory.
And I guess the state doesn't see that as turning it into punishment, that flipping that one fact and having the remedy just be through, if it was only through the criminal case.
Well, what do you mean just that one fact? The fact is somebody may have to register for 25 years or for 15 years or for their life based on a fact that was untrue, and the legislature has provided no means to challenge that, then that's pretty compelling.
And I guess
isn't it? And your civil suit is not the analog. Yesterday the civil suit was whether the to attack the Registration Act, which would be in Doe v. Thompson, was a declaratory judgment action. I don't know how you follow a declaratory judgment action to challenge a factual finding of a district court. I mean, that's not the same animal. And so if there's no way to challenge that, other than possibly through the criminal case, then why doesn't that look penal? Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes. I mean, the only thing I can go back to, Your Honor, is the intent that it's supposed to protect public safety and provide notice, and the mechanism to do that in certain cases where factual findings have to be found is provided for at the sentencing hearing,
The intent doesn't carries through unless the effects override that intent, and that's what we're asking here. If you're going to be bound by this and have no recourse to challenge a judge's factual findings, why isn't that effect on the person, forgetting public safety, but on this person, why isn't that effect so penal as to override the public safety intent? And that's the focus.
And Your Honor, I don't know if I have a good answer to give you.
Let me ask a similar question, but a different way. We're looking at trying to discern the intent of the legislature. Was the intent penal or a civil remedial scheme? And certainly the legislature knows how to draft statutes that impose all kinds of regulations as civil schemes for the public good. Do you know of any other such regulatory scheme in our statutes that give citizens no recourse of appeal of an administrative decision?
Off the top of my head, I don't, Your Honor.
Yeah. Wouldn't it seem logical to conclude that if the legislature really intended this to be a civil remedial scheme, they would have included a mechanism for review of those administrative decisions?
I mean, I suppose, yes.
When we're talking about public safety, DUI is right at the top of the list, this court has said that, and you still have administratively the right to have a hearing through the administrative process.
But consequences of your driver's license and things?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And here, what I'm hearing you saying is you have to be creative and find some cause of action under Chapter 60 is the only way you can go, and I'm not seeing what kind of action that would be on a factual finding.
Right. I mean, I guess it got to this court this way through a direct appeal. But you're saying
that it's not part of the sentence, and so if it's not part of the sentence, part of the criminal case, and Simmons said it didn't have jurisdiction, didn't they? Or there were subsequent cases. Ward and Wood said we don't even have jurisdiction because...
Through a motion to correct an illegal
right.
sentence,
right.
yes.
In criminal court, we don't have jurisdiction, yeah.
Yes, because it's not a part of the sentence. Your Honor, I just don't know if I have a good answer to give you in this moment. And I apologize, and I see I'm out of time.
Any further questions? Any further presentation?
No, thank you.
Thank you, counsel.
May it please the court. I have no additional argument to make at this time. Unless this court has any further questions, I'm prepared to waive rebuttal.
I see none. Thank you, counsel. Thank you both for your arguments this morning. The court will take this matter under advisement. call the second case on this morning's docket, case number 111227, State of Kansas v. Christopher Marinelli.
May it please the court, Kimberly Streit Vogelsberg of the Appellant Defender's Office is here on behalf of the appellant Christopher Marinelli. I request 3 minutes for rebuttal, if I may.
3 minutes is granted.
Thank you. Allow me briefly to go through the facts of this case. Mr. Marinelli pled no contest to the crime of aggravated assault. At the plea hearing, he was not advised that he was going to have to register under CORA. And the district court never made a specific finding on the record that he committed this offense with a deadly weapon. However, the district court did go ahead and impose the 15-year registration that is given to violent offenders, and Mr. Marinelli appealed. The Court of Appeals found that the district court was proper to impose that registration because the registration was not punitive, and we filed a petition arguing that the Court of Appeals is wrong, and that is what I am here to argue today. So,
Counselor, could you refresh my recollection a little bit on the facts? There was a knife involved here, but was it an argument between two people, or how did it come about that the defendant swiped at the victim with a knife?
I don't actually know that. I do know that he did plead to committing the crime with the deadly weapon, a knife. So he is not contesting that the knife was used in the crime.
Well, no, my purpose is I'm trying to discern here on these various cases how registration and public notification affects any kind of safety for the public.
Yes.
If you have a fight with a friend, it wouldn't make a difference if they were a registered offender. And so I was just trying to get the underlying facts here to see if this was something that the victim could have avoided by going to the CORA registry.
And to answer that question, I would argue no, just as those who've, the other appellants before me have argued, no, that purpose is not served by this type of registration. And that's one of the main arguments that we have as to why this is not punishment. Obviously, I am going to argue that the Court of Appeals' reliance on Simmons was wrong for two reasons, one of which is because Simmons' conclusion that registration is not punitive is incorrect. And I don't really have anything further on that argument than the arguments made by counsel before me.
Before we get there, as a preliminary matter, it seems undisputed that the district court did not make the finding that it's required to make under the statute.
Yes.
Also seems undisputed that the Court of Appeals held that the district court failed to comply with the provision of the statute that says you're supposed to make the finding upon which this statute gets triggered.
Yes.
Why aren't we done?
Well, that is exactly my argument. CORA registration can be imposed several different ways under CORA, one of which for sex offenders is you commit the crime, the listed crime, and CORA is triggered and registration occurs. However, in these type of cases that fall under subsection E2, the triggering event is not the conviction itself. The E2 requires an additional judicial finding that the crime was committed with a deadly weapon.
Wasn't that an element of the crime here, though?
Yeah. It was, but
so once the judge made an adjudication of guilt, wasn't that finding made by the judge?
No, I think that CORA requires a specific finding on the record, and here that finding was not made.
Why do you have to use magic words if by finding someone guilty you have found them to have committed a crime, the element of which is to use a deadly weapon?
I think that that's and that's exactly what the district court tried to say at sentencing, is that this finding is inherent. And I don't think that an inherent finding is the same thing as a judicial finding on the record. And actually what occurs is a lot of times people will negotiate this as part of your plea, or even though that crime may have had that as part of an element, an inherent fact finding as part of the element of the crime itself, the district court will decline to make that finding to honor the defendant's plea agreement that registration not occur. So it definitely seems to be, and I think Court of Appeals cases have found, that this finding, this triggering finding, is discretionary by the court and is an additional level that must be done. So to say that it's inherent and there's not a specific finding to be made doesn't give, doesn't recognize the district court's discretionary power as to whether or not to make that finding and increase that sentence, that punitive sentence.
Let's assume the magic words are required, and they weren't. Why should that void the registration requirement?
Well, because Cora has no other way of imposing registration on someone like Mr. Marinelli without that finding being made. The Court of Appeals said that no finding had been made. Therefore, registration is erroneous. Cora doesn't say if it's part of the underlying plea, if it's part of the underlying conviction. Cora requires, in my argument, that specific finding, and it was not made. And so therefore, we have no registration in this case until that triggering event occurs.
You don't claim any prejudice. This is really sort of a gotcha deal, right?
Yes. I mean, the prejudice occurred when he was supposed to receive notice of this at the time of his conviction, and his plea agreement specifically said, I understand I will not have to register.
But we fixed that when we said you could withdraw it.
Yes.
It still gets back to there's no prejudice to him about being told that he had to register at the plea part, assuming the plea is still good, versus being told at sentencing that you were going to have to register.
Well, I think there is a difference between that, because if his plea was contingent on the fact that he wouldn't have to register and he never received that notice, and it was imposed at sentencing and he received notice then, that's obviously prejudicial. He entered a plea. He gave
given the opportunity to withdraw his plea.
Right.
So that's why I'm saying,
yes.
Okay, if the plea's contingent on registration, he had a back door.
Yes, in this specific case, he was given the opportunity to withdraw his plea.
So we're still back to no prejudice.
Yes, but the statutes, we don't just skip over statutes because there's no prejudice. If the statute was never triggered, at some point we need to make sure that that's triggered. We don't just assume things and not fix them, I would argue. So at the very least, Mr. Marinelli deserves some type of remand for the district court to actually make that finding. If that finding is discretionary, the district court needs to be afforded the opportunity to make that finding. And that's where...
Could a judge accept a plea to ag assault based on a deadly weapon and then turn around and make a finding on the record that a deadly weapon was not used?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying can occur, and that's why it's important to have that finding be on the record as the statute requires. So,
what's the factual basis for the plea, if you can take a plea without one of the elements being met?
Well, I'm saying he can plead to those elements. He can plead to using a knife, but the Cora statutes registration is not triggered on what are the elements of the crime. Registration is not triggered on the elements of the plea. Registration is triggered on a specific judicial finding, and that's what did not occur in this case. And that's how you can have that that difference, and that's where the court's discretion can come in, even in a case where one was used to withhold that, given certain other parts of the plea agreement or the district court's discretion.
Okay.
So we would argue that a remand would be necessary to correct that. And in this case, even though this was not an Apprendi brief, this was not an Apprendi argument that was made in this case, if you find that for purposes of an Apprendi argument that this is punishment, then any type of remand would be moot, because essentially the triggering event, which would be the judicial fact finding, is unconstitutional for Apprendi purposes, so that ruling would benefit him in this case, even though he's not specifically making that argument. However, and that's if you choose to do a remand. However, I mean, Mr. Marinelli is arguing that because the statutes specifically require the notice to be given at conviction to avoid the type of prejudice that was discussed previously, that the fact-finding also needs to be done at the time of conviction. And so a remand wouldn't cure that type of error, and that this court should just find that because the finding was not made, that was the district court's one opportunity to impose registration, and that time has passed, sentencing is complete, and you should not be able to go back in and open that up again.
And that argument is founded on your argument that Simmons is wrong.
Yes.
And you started on why it was wrong for two reasons, and you stated the first one is that the non-punitive holding is just incorrect. I'm not sure I discerned the second reason.
Yes, the second reason would be because Simmons obviously says that registration is an automatic operation of law. It's not automatic in these cases, as I've been arguing. There is an additional triggering event, and I think the state in its previous argument acknowledged that. It's not just the conviction that triggers it. It requires that additional judicial fact-finding, and that's what we're arguing. Whether or not that occurs, that's the triggering event. So Simmons says, well, even if you didn't announce that, or even if you didn't give them notice of that, it happened automatically. It's mandatory pursuant to the conviction by statute. And that's not the case in these E2 subsection cases, because it's not the conviction that triggers. It's not mandatory. It's discretionary based on the triggering event of the district court's fact finding. So for those two reasons, Simmons is wrong and does not control in this case. Therefore, the Court of Appeals' reliance on Simmons is misguided. I don't have any further arguments if there's no other questions.
I see no questions. Thank you, Counsel.
Thank you.
May it please the Court, the State appears by Assistant Solicitor General Natalie Chalmers. There can be no Apprendi violation in this case. The only finding that was made in this case was already found by the court when it entered the plea. No district court can make a finding that...
Can you back up here just for a moment? That's kind of form a foundation here. I understand that the state and the defendant entered into plea negotiations and entered into an acknowledgement of that included that registration was not a part of the sentence or a part of the requirement for the defendant. Is that right?
Yeah, there was from my understanding of the facts, I've never seen the underlying record, that there was a acknowledgement that registration would not be required.
So why did the state then argue for registration at sentencing, in fact, point out that that was a requirement when it agreed that it wasn't? How did you get there?
I don't know. There's nothing in the record, and...
And I understand there was an offer to withdraw a plea and all that, but this seems to me... that just at the outset, there's a misunderstanding, maybe, is to giving you too much credit. It seems like it's a breach of the plea agreement. If that was an understanding and that was an agreement by the state, and then at sentencing, it's brought up by the state that there's a requirement to register, I don't understand how that's a consistent position at plea. Is it?
From what I understand, from what the Court of Appeals said, it wasn't part of the plea agreement. It was some other document or something. It wasn't part of the plea as was discussed by the district court. I'm not entirely sure what happened at all. If it was a breach of the plea agreement, the remedy would have been the same remedy the district court offered, which is, do you want to withdraw your plea? He didn't. So at that point, the plea was modified.
But your position is that it can't be part of the plea agreement because it's not part of the sentence. I mean, that's what Simmons says. It's not part of the sentence. So how can you plea? How can it be part of the plea agreement? Collateral consequence of the judgment that arises automatically by operation of law. So how can it even be part of the plea agreement under Simmons' rule?
Well, a plea agreement is a contract negotiation. We include things sometimes like bids fees and, well, I guess restitution is part of the sentence. You can include things that are not sentencing or anything.
But
in a plea
agreement. Under the state's entire sort of global theory of the Offender Registration Act, it's an administrative remedial scheme that's administered essentially by the executive branch, other agencies. How do prosecutors even have discretion to make that part of any plea negotiations under the state's own theory of the statute?
They wouldn't, and when it's a matter of law. I'm not standing here saying that there doesn't need to be a finding by the district court. There does have to be a finding under E2 to trigger registration. And it is common practice that the state just says, well, we just won't ask them to make the finding. That doesn't mean the district court can't make the finding. You're right. We can't bind the district court to say you can't do CORA or that you can't make this finding. The district court has its own independent duty or authority to say, well, I find anyway that there is a deadly weapon.
So you're saying a district court does have discretion to determine whether a person that's being prosecuted in that court has to register. That a district court can just determine, I'm not going to make the finding of record, and then this person won't have to register.
The statute requires an additional finding, so if the additional finding isn't made, registration isn't required.
So how does that make it, if the district court is controlling whether a person registers or not, by whether it pronounces a finding on the record, how is that an automatic, by operation of law, collateral consequence?
It's only an automatic, by operation of law, when it is in one of the enumerated list of crimes that's like aggravated sodomy, you have to register. This is not, the crime itself does not require registration. This particular crime, there is an additional finding that is needed. Well, actually, here, we have the element that the finding needs to be made is part of the plea. So it's somewhat different than the last case where, yes, there was an actual additional finding that needed to be made. Here, the finding that needed to be made was made when the plea occurred.
That's the inherent argument.
Yeah.
But you are saying that Simmons is an error, at least in those cases where a separate finding has to be made, that it's not automatic?
It's automatic once the finding is made, but if there is another thing that needs to happen, I don't think that Simmons can be, I agree with Simmons as to the fact of Simmons' case, but in the cases where there is another finding that you have another step before it becomes an automatic registration requirement.
And once the finding is made, it's automatic, and it's non-punitive, collateral consequence that can't be appealed in the criminal case. Would that be accurate?
I'm not sure that it can't be appealed in the criminal case, that you can't challenge the sufficiency of the finding in a direct appeal. I've not seen it done one way or the other.
Well, how do we get there if we're saying it's a civil regulatory process?
You allow bids?
Not part of the sentence. And not part of the criminal prosecution, how can you appeal it under the criminal case?
You can with bids fees. Bids fees are not part of the criminal sentence. They're not part of criminal punishment. You allow bids fees challenges all the time because they don't conform to the statute. If in the direct appeal you're to say, this finding doesn't conform to the statute, I think you could do a direct appeal on that.
But aren't the bid fees part of the criminal code? That attorney fees can be ordered by the court.
Chapter 22, aren't they?
I don't know him.
Right.
But they are, I mean, this court, I believe, or at least the Court of Appeals upheld the bids fees are not part of the punishment, they're recruitment, they're their own civil proceeding. It would be kind of comparable to the offender registration. But here...
But as soon as you put discretion in, as soon as the judge has the right to say this isn't a registration case, aren't you moving to intent?
I don't think so. I mean, the defense's whole point is they want the judge to have more discretion to be able to take them off the registry. If in the beginning the judge gets to decide, is this person a danger to the public so they need to be on the registry, why is that suddenly more punitive? I don't think it is.
Well, it seems to me that if you're saying that some cases are lesser degree of danger, if you will, and others are more, then you're looking at some type of a punishment for that person. You're evaluating the degree of the center, the intent element, if you get back to the Mendoza factors.
The judge is attempting to evaluate the danger to the public. Is this person a public safety hazard because of their use of a dangerous weapon? That's all this court's doing. But to the extent this court disagrees with me and wants to, I think that we need to remember the act is severable, and if you need to strike down that finding portion, the state would urge that you just do that. But here, this is a direct criminal appeal, and no one's arguing that she, I think it's a she, can't register in the future. This, even if this is a part of the sentence, nothing was done improperly here. There is no Apprendi violation. I'm not saying that registration is part of the sentence. I stand by Simmons and everything that's been said in the last 2 days. The state does not believe offender registration is part of the sentence. But you're going through a lot of evaluation I don't think is necessary in this case. The only question in this case is what happens when notice isn't given at the time of the plea entry. We don't have, well, it's a 2011 retroactive issue or anything. It is literally just, was notice properly given in this case? Because clearly the finding was already made when the plea happened. The statute doesn't say what happens when notice is or isn't given. If Cora is, as this court found in Peterson Doe, going to be applied retroactively, the failure to comply with the notice provisions can't be a reason that we can't require registration. And in fact, the notice provisions have several opportunities to give notice. It's not just the district court that gives notice, it's the law enforcement agencies, the KDOC, etc. So here, it's just, okay, yeah, the finding was made, it wasn't made at the time of conviction. Can it be made at sentencing? And the state's answer in this case is yes.
So that's how you would get around the Court of Appeals holding that the district court had failed to comply with the statute. You're saying that, you're basically saying that that is correct, that the Court of Appeals was correct when it said that the district court failed to comply with the statute. You're saying you can come back and do it later.
As long as the district court still has jurisdiction, and they did here at sentencing, the court made the finding and, in fact, gave him the opportunity to withdraw his plea, so there is no prejudice to him in this case. He had notice, it was a little too late, but no harm, no foul is essentially what the state is saying. Or you can say that the conviction isn't entered until the sentencing anyway, and so that it can be done at sentencing. Those reasons, I'm sorry?
I guess I just got confused there at the end. It sounded like in your answer to Justice Biles' question, you acknowledged that the Court of Appeals held that the key finding was not made.
At the time of the plea, I think this, yes.
Well, do you agree with that interpretation of the Court of Appeals' opinion or not? The Court of Appeals said the proper finding was not made.
Right.
And so my confusion is, how do you get around that?
Well, I do think the district court...
Yeah, and you're talking about notice, but that's irrelevant to whether the finding was made.
Right. I do think the district court here said, I didn't need to make any additional findings.
I understand that. And I'm sympathetic to the argument that perhaps the Court of Appeals was wrong.
Okay.
But I'm asking a different question. The Court of Appeals found that the finding wasn't made. And that finding of the Court of Appeals is not before us on any petition for review, is it?
Correct.
Okay. And so back to the very first question that was asked, why doesn't that end this case?
I don't know that I read the District Court of Appeals opinion as saying no finding was made at sentencing so much as they said no finding was made at the plea. I could be misreading what they said. So I didn't think that there was no finding at all, because here, I mean, they clearly state in their fact statement that the District Court said, well, I didn't need to make any finding because it was an element inherent in the offense and I'm requiring registration.
Well, let's not guess.
Yeah.
See what the Court of Appeals said. The trial court failed to comply with KSA 2012 sup 22-4904A1A, which is the other part, the one we care about, I think, is, and KSA 2012 sup 22-402E2. So, period. So it didn't say failed to comply earlier. It just said it failed to comply with the statute. What do we do with this?
And I guess
the problem.
Yeah, I understand that. And I guess I read it as the and was because they were reading 42 or 4904 to require it to be done at the time of conviction. Not that the finding was never made, because they clearly have the factual statement that the finding was made. But if my failure to cross appeal means that the district court can never make the finding, then that's what it means. Unless I know that counsel did ask for a remand and you're willing to give it to us, then we can at remand have the district court make the right finding and there's notice.
Does that conclude your presentation?
I believe it does.
Do we have any questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
I just have one point kind of along that line of argument as to what the Court of Appeals opinion stated. That is my argument, that the Court of Appeals found that the finding was not made, and the Court of Appeals opinion actually recognizes that the state argued on appeal that the error was remedied, and that this inherent finding, but the Court of Appeals did not base its holding on that fact. The state did not appeal that, so I think that is not before this court, and this court must assume that the finding was not made, be it inherent or otherwise.
So why are you asking for a remand to let the district court fix that?
Well, I'm not asking for a remand. I'm asking that you just say that there's no registration. I'm saying if you decide to give a remand, we would still win based on the fact that this is punishment and an Apprendi violation would occur if you try to impose the statute on a remand. And I have nothing further. Thank you.
Thank both counsel for the arguments this morning. The court will take this matter under advisement. At this time, the court will be in recess for 15 minutes.